Our subject today, again, is the 25:20 of Leviticus chapter 26, or the so-called seven times. And the reason that we're going to be talking about this today, and looking at it very thoroughly, I might add, is that I have some very good friends who have become involved in a certain position on this subject in Leviticus chapter 26, and it has caused them to feel like that they need to separate from others because of it. They also believe that those who cannot agree with their position will not receive the latter rain, will not receive the seal of God and be lost. I think those are pretty serious issues, don't you? And I don't want to be lost, and I don't want you to be lost, and of course, I don't want them to be lost. I've had to take time to thoroughly, deeply study this issue out. I wanted to be sure for myself. I didn't want to take what anyone said, or any person, what their thoughts on it were. I wanted to know what inspiration had to say about this. I wanted to know what the facts were. Now, I might just add one note of caution, too. There are some people who have already said, based upon what they think I'm going to say today, that I'm using something called higher criticism to arrive at my positions. Even though they haven't heard what I said, this is what has been brought back to me. I just want to say that if you were with us Wednesday night, we had a study on higher criticism Wednesday night. It made very clear what higher criticism is and is not. And if you will look at that study, and that presentation is posted on our website, you will see very clearly that the hermeneutics we're going to use today, when I say hermeneutics, I'm talking about the method of Bible study that we're going to use today, is very consistent with our pioneers' hermeneutics. It's very consistent with what the Spirit of Prophecy teaches for hermeneutics, and is in no way what is simply called higher criticism. God's people today are faced, in many respects, with a great challenge similar to what the early apostolic church faced. They have a message to give, and there are so few workers, so few people seemingly to be able to help. Obviously, this work cannot be accomplished without heavenly help. Human resources are not enough. We must engage the powers of heaven, friends, or our cause is hopeless. Concerning the early church, we have been told, only as they were united with Christ could the disciples hope to have the accompanying power of the Holy Spirit and the cooperation of angels of heaven. With the help of these divine agencies, they would present before the world a united front and would be victorious in the conflict they were compelled to wage unceasingly against the powers of darkness. Now notice, she says that there was to be a united front that was to be given to the world. She continues, as they should continue to labor unitedly, heavenly messengers would go before them, opening the way. Hearts would be prepared for the reception of truth, and many would be won to Christ. So long as they remain united, the church would go forth, fair as the moon, clear as the sun, and terrible as an army with banners. Song of Solomon, chapter 6 and verse 10. Nothing could withstand her onward progress. The church would advance from victory to victory, gloriously fulfilling her divine mission of proclaiming the gospel to the world. And that's from Ellen White's book, Acts of the Apostles, pages 90 and 91. Now, beloved, it must not be missed that the work could not go forward single-handedly, but only as a united front. That united front comes from being united with Christ. As each person becomes united with Christ, then they become united with each other. And as they should continue to labor unitedly, heavenly messengers would go before them, opening the way. The same was true in the early Advent movement. Believers from various different denominations came together, who were at first focused on the second, the very soon, they believed, second coming of Jesus Christ. They had the great disappointment of October 1844, and out of that, a remnant appeared who continued the apostolic teachings and the unity of the faith once delivered to the saints. By 1863, when the official denomination was framed, or was formed, they had a united position on the fundamental points of faith. And in 1872, a list of those 25 fundamentals was published, and it was noted in those fundamentals that these were the doctrines that were held with great unanimity among them as a people. Interestingly, absent from that list of fundamentals, was any reference to, for example, the King of the North from Daniel 11, the Daily of Daniel 8, or the so-called 25-20 prophecy of Leviticus chapter 26. Today, there are those among the conservative, historic Advent movement that claims to believe, many of them claiming to believe the truth about God, who would like to draw finer lines requiring a correct belief, for instance, in the King of the North, or an acceptance of the so-called 25-20 prophecy. If you cannot agree with them, then you are considered to be on the road to destruction. But we have been told, and I'd like to share with you another statement from Acts of the Apostles, page 96. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. 1 Corinthians 14:33. He requires that order and system be observed in the conduct of church affairs today, no less than in the days of old. He desires his work to be carried forward with thoroughness and exactness so that he may place upon it the seal of his approval. Christian is to be united with Christian, church with church, the human instrumentality cooperating with the divine, every agency subordinate to the Holy Spirit, and all combined in giving to the world the good tidings of the grace of God. Acts of the Apostles, page 96. And so, beloved, I believe, and I think it's clear, that we have an obligation to come into the unity of the faith. Certainly, we should be able to do this on all the major fundamentals. On other points, Christian liberty should be maintained in love. One minor point, and I say a minor point because it was not part of the fundamentals, but one minor point that the pioneers came into unity on was a consensus about the seven times of Leviticus chapter 26. And so let's look now at some background to the seven times. The text of Leviticus chapter 26, verses 18 through 28, have been the point of contention. They've been the point of contention. Verses 3 through 12 of Leviticus 26 describe the blessings that God will give to his people, Israel, if they are obedient. And verses 14 through 39 describe the results of not following God's plan and refusing to keep his commandments. And specifically, verses 18, 21, 24, and 28. In those verses, we find the term seven times in the King James Version of the Bible. Now, William Miller, a great man, a great student of the Bible, a man used by God in a great way, William Miller, with people like Joshua Himes and others, understood this term to be prophetic, representing 7 years of prophetic days. The seven times were thus to be understood as seven times 360 or 2,520 years of literal time. That's understanding that, for instance, in a year there are 12 months, and in the biblical month there are 30 days, and so you do the math. Anyway, you add it up, it comes out to be 2,520. This date, at first, was understood to end in 1843, at the same time that the 2,300 days of Daniel 8:14 were to expire. Both dates were later revised to 1844. Miller and others, presenting the message on the imminent second coming of Christ, began to use charts as visual aids to help explain the prophecies. The most famous chart, early chart, became known as the 1843 chart. Ellen White noted about this chart. She said, as early as 1842, the Spirit of God had moved upon Charles Fitch to devise the prophetic chart, which was generally regarded by Adventists as a fulfillment of the command given by the prophet Habakkuk to write the vision and make it plain upon tables. And that's Ellen White's book, The Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 4, page 241, 4SP 241. On these charts, The explanation of Daniel 8:14 was given, as well as the explanation of the seven times, or the 25:20 of Leviticus chapter 26. Miller taught that the seven times, or the 25:20 years, began in 677 BC with the captivity of Manasseh. In writing about the seven times of Leviticus 26, Miller, Fitch, Himes, and others were not presenting necessarily anything new or unique. As early as the 6th century, Anastasius, the patriarch of Antioch, connected the seven times with the 25:20 years, and there were other contemporaries who wrote about it, and even people before Miller. For instance, Matthew Habershon, a contemporary of Miller, wrote about the 25:20 in his A Dissertation on the Prophetic Scriptures, and that was published in 1834, just shortly after Miller began his study. Like some of the Millerites, Habershon declared that the prophecy actually had a double commencement, using the dates 727 BC and 677 BC, and of course it had two ending fulfillments as well. And other writers came up with different times. Now, I should just let you know that this study in detail, what you're hearing today, is actually an abridged or abbreviated study of a more detailed study that we have produced in the June 2017 issue of OLPAS. And in that issue, there are many footnotes that will fill in some of these details that I'm simply making a statement of fact now, but will give you the proof or the references for these kind of statements. But today our time, which will go long enough, will preclude going through all those details and footnotes. But after the, and by the way, for those listening to this, I would encourage you to get the paper and go through all the fine details. Prove it out for yourself. Find out if what we're saying today is true. Because if it's not, we don't need it. But friends, if it's truth, then it must stand and we must obey it. After the disappointment of 1844, the early Adventists continued to support the idea of the seven times of Leviticus and that it was a prophecy of 2,520 years. But by 1860, this concept was dropped, and by 1863, a call was made for a new chart to be made. This new 1863 chart had no mention of the seven times of Leviticus 26 on it, nor did it mention a period of 2,520 years. In 1864, James White, of course he was the husband of who? Ellen White. He wrote positively against the 25:20, and his position was supported in print later by Uriah Smith. Now today, we have new proponents of this so-called 25:20 prophecy who are trying to make the 25:20 a test of one's endorsement of Ellen White and of historic Adventism. But friends, James White, Uriah Smith, in addition to the silence of every leading pioneer since 1864, speaks otherwise. And we're going to look at this in greater detail a little later in our study. But now I think it's time that we do an examination of these key verses in Leviticus chapter 26. So open your Bibles, if you would please, to Leviticus chapter 26. And we're going to start in verse 14. Now, verses 3 through 13 promise blessings for obedience, and verses 14 through 39 talk about the increasingly difficult curses for disobedience. And again, we want you to be paying particular attention to verses 18, 21, 24, and 28, because they speak of punishments involving seven times. So we're going to read these verses in their context. And we're going to start here now with Leviticus chapter 26 and verse 14 through 16 on our first slide we have here. It says, "But if ye will not hearken unto me, and will not do all these commandments, and if ye shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my judgments, so that ye will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I also will do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, and the burning ague, that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart, and ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it." Verse 17. "And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and ye shall flee when none pursueth you. And if ye will not yet for all this hearken unto me, then will I punish you, what? Seven times more for your sins. Verse 19. And I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass. And your strength shall be spent in vain, for your land shall not yield her increase, neither shall the trees of the land yield their fruits. Verse 21 now. And if you walk contrary unto me, and will not hearken unto me, I will bring seven times more plagues upon you according to your sins. I will also send wild beasts among you, which shall rob you of your children, and destroy your cattle, and make you few in number, and your highways shall be desolate. Verse 23. And if ye will not be reformed by me by these things, but will walk contrary to me, then will I also walk contrary unto you, and I will punish you yet seven times for your sins. Verse 25. And I will bring a sword upon you that shall avenge the quarrel of my covenant. And when ye are gathered together within your cities, I will send the pestilence among you, and ye shall be delivered unto the hand of the enemy. And when I have broken the staff of your bread, 10 women shall bake your bread in one oven, and they shall deliver you your bread again by weight, and ye shall eat and not be satisfied. And if ye will not for all this hearken unto me, but walk contrary unto me, verse 28, then I will walk contrary unto you also in fury, and I, even I, will chastise you seven times for your sins. Now verse 29. And ye shall eat the flesh of your sons, and the flesh of your daughters shall ye eat. And I will destroy your high places, and cut down your images, and cast your carcasses upon the carcasses of your idols, and my soul shall abhor you. And I will make your cities waste, and bring your sanctuaries unto desolation, and I will not smell the savor of your sweet odors. Verse 32. And I will bring the land into desolation, and your enemies which dwell therein shall be astonished at it. And I will scatter you among the heathen, and will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate, and your cities waste. And he goes on with a little bit more, but I think we have enough of the context. Now again, William Miller and others believed that the seven times that are mentioned in verses 18, 21, 24, and where was the other one? 28. Should be understood as a prophecy with a symbolic time period. Miller and his associates connected the seven times with Daniel 4:16 and 23, where it was prophesied that Nebuchadnezzar would live like a wild beast for 7 years. Instead of the seven times of Leviticus being literal time, as in Daniel, however, it was considered to be symbolic, a day for a year, and thus the seven times would be seven times 360, because there's 12 months to the year, 30 days to the biblical month. 12 times 30 is 360. 7 times 360 is 2,520. And they believed this would be literal time. And there were just basically everyone believing this at the time. But I want to tell you something, friends. There are several unscalable problems with this interpretation, and the first being in the very language of the text. When one examines the Hebrew text of Leviticus, one finds that unlike Daniel 4, where there are two different Hebrew words, you have in Daniel 4, you have seven times, and in Daniel 4, there's a Hebrew word for seven and a Hebrew word for times. But unlike that, in Leviticus 26, in each of those verses, there's only one word, and it's the word for seven. There is no word for times. Now, that word in the Hebrew is seba. Though not italicized to show it is supplied, the word times in verses 18, 21, 24, and 20 is supplied, and it is not in the original text. And all you have to do is get a Strong's Concordance and look up the word times. And you'll see that when you go out to look for the Strong's number in those verses, it's empty, because there is no word in the original Hebrew for it. Now, this word seba in the Hebrew that's used here, Josephus, in his Hebrew Chaldean lexicon, he shows that it is actually an adverb form of the word. And this is the word for seven. And it's an adverb form. And here you see we have, now he doesn't list every reference or every place where this form of it is used as an adverb, but he gives a few examples. But here he gives Leviticus 26, 18, and 21. But if you will look at the Hebrew text in verses 24 and 28, you'll find it's the exact same form of the word. It doesn't change its form. Okay? Now this contrasts with the usage in Daniel 4, where the Hebrew is sabaah. And here, it is clearly in the context of a noun. And you see, I just have a Bible program that shows these kind of things. And so I've circled the seven here under, it shows that it's used as a noun here. The form is used as a noun here in this. To state the matter in a simple way, from a point of grammar. And by the way, you know, language isn't any good without grammar, is it? If we don't understand grammar, we really can't communicate, friends. We can't communicate properly, for sure. But looking at it from a simple point of grammar, adjectives. Adjectives describe nouns, and adverbs modify verbs. Adjectives can tell, for example, the quantity of a certain noun. Remember adjectives in school? Which, what kind of, or how many? But what do adverbs tell us? How, when, or where? You remember that from English. We all remember those basic rules. The adverb can tell the quality of the verb it modifies. And the verbs used, if you look in Leviticus 26 here, in 18, 21, 24, and 28, the verbs are will punish, will bring, will punish, and will chastise. And so this word that's translated seven is used as an adverb to tell us the quality of this punishment or this chastisement. The adverbs are not words that tell the number of the chastisements or the punishment, but are words to show how the verbs manifest themselves. In other words, the adverbs for these verbs show the intensity of the verbs, and this is simply grammar. Moses, friends, did not intend the text in Leviticus to be a specific time period, but rather to be an expression of intensity using seven, which is the number of perfection and completeness. And in the footnotes of the study, I have several verses to substantiate that. Some other translations who understood this, the translators who understood this, have given these verses something like this. In Leviticus 26, 18, in the ESV, it says, "And if in spite of this you will not listen to me, then will I discipline you again sevenfold for your sins." You see, sevenfold. It's just expressing it a little differently. In the Darby translation, "And if for this ye hearken not unto me, I will punish you sevenfold more for your sins." And the New Revised Standard Version says, "And if in spite of this you will not obey me, I will continue to punish you sevenfold for your sins." And I think that that translation is much more accurate and gives the reader an easier connotation of what God is trying to say. Now, Elder James White noted, and I learned this first from Elder White myself, but then I looked at it in the original to make sure it was true, but here's what he said. "And in all cases where the word time occurs denoting a prophetic period, as in Daniel 7:25, 12:7, Revelation 12:14, it is from the noun karios. Such a thing as a prophetic period based upon an adverb is not to be found." In other words, if the supposed time element is based upon an adverb, it's not really a time element at all. It can't be. There's no precedent for that anywhere else in the Bible. It's always in a different form if it's expressing an element of literal or prophetic times. Now, interestingly, we as Adventists, we should be experts in studying these prophecies because we place so much emphasis, especially on Daniel and Revelation, and you know we call those apocalyptic prophecies, don't we? And the apocalyptic prophecies of Daniel and Revelation, beloved, are not conditional prophecies. They are all stated as events that will happen. In fact, in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 1, it says, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to shew unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass, and he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John." However, the prophecy of Leviticus 26, and you still have your Bibles open to it, I think, or you can if you are not there now. This prophecy is conditional. And if you look at it, you'll find that there's a little two-letter word used throughout it, and it's if. If. And outside, friends, of specific direction, the year-day principle of interpretation is not to be used on non-symbolic, non-apocalyptic prophecy. This has been the way Adventists have always used the year-day principle. For example, the 120 years of the flood in Genesis 6:3. That's considered literal time. That was not to be counted as symbolic time prophecy. The 70 years of captivity that Jeremiah and Daniel speak about, that was literal time, not symbolic. The 7 years of madness of Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel 4, literal time. Now this period, this so-called period of 2520 years, is not comparable to time prophecies. Let me explain that. If the seven times of Leviticus 26 were a prophecy, and if they were of the important magnitude that some claim that they are, then we should be able to find very specific beginning and specific ending dates for the prophecy, like we can, the 2300 days, or, for instance, the 1260 years. For example, in Daniel 9:25, we have here the specific beginning date for the 70 years, and thus also for the 2300 years, because we know that these two work together. Daniel 9:25 says simply, "Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem and to the Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks, the street shall be built again and the wall even in troublous times." All Adventist biblical students agree that the 2300 days of Daniel 8:14 begin with the 70 weeks of Daniel 9. And together, Daniel 8:14 and Daniel 9:25 give us the starting time for the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem. And in the Bible itself, in Ezra chapter 7, we find the verbatim decree given there by the king. And this is a well-documented decree, and it's documented to begin in 457 B.C. The ending time of this prophecy is denoted in Leviticus chapter 16, where it discusses the Day of Atonement, and we understand that from the Jewish calendar that that was to occur on October 22 of 1844 in that year, thus finishing the 2300-day year prophecy. There are, however, no specific dates, however, for the seven times beyond speculation. Adventist scholar Gernhard Fondel has noted this. According to the Millerites, 677 B.C. was the year in which King Manasseh, 696 to 642 B.C., was taken as a prisoner to Babylon, 2 Chronicles 33:11, and the 2520 years of punishment of God's people began. There is no historical evidence, however, that Manasseh was taken to Babylon in 677 B.C. This year goes back to the chronology of James Usher in the 17th century. Manasseh was co-regent with his father Hezekiah for the first 10 years of his reign. His sole reign of 42 years began in 686 B.C. If this imprisonment and subsequent conversion occurred in 677 B.C., 9 years after the beginning of his sole reign, he still reigned for more than 30 years after his conversion and return to Judah. But this is not the picture the Bible presents of Manasseh's reign. He continues, "The Bible gives the impression that most of his life was spent in apostasy and that only toward the end of his life did he turn to the Lord. Speaking of Manasseh's conversion, Ellen White wrote that his, quote, repentance, remarkable though it was, came too late to save the kingdom from the corrupting influence of the years of idolatrous practices. Many had stumbled and fallen, never again to rise, end quote. And that's from Patriarchs and Prophets, page 382. Fundel continues, "Many Bible scholars believe that his imprisonment took place in connection with the rebellion of Assurbanipal's brother Samsumukka-kun during the year 652 to 648 BC. Yet even if the date 677 were correct, it would not indicate the beginning of the punishment of God's people, because only the king was taken to Babylon, and only for a short time. He returned to Jerusalem, destroyed all the idols he had erected, and restored the worship of God, 2 Chronicles 33:15 and 16. The kingdom of Judah continued another 80 years, until in 586 BC, Nebuchadnezzar destroyed Jerusalem and the temple of God. These 80 years included the reign of good King Josiah, 640 to 609, whose reign can in no way be classified as a punishment on Judah. In other words, the year 677 BC does not fit historically or chronologically. Now, do you understand what Fondal is saying? Two points are established. Firstly, the year that was used by Miller, according to Usher's chronology, 677 BC, is not reliable. And secondly, even if it were, it cannot be a fulfillment of the prediction, because Leviticus 26 is not speaking about the captivity or the punishment of a specific king. It's speaking about the whole nation of Israel. Furthermore, because Josiah's heart was tender and humble, according to 2 Kings 22:19, God promised not to bring the punishment against the people during his time. And that was after Manasseh. The Millerites used 677 BC because it simply seemed to fit. They believed something was happening in 1843. And if you take 2520 and you count backward, as they were doing the method that they were doing at that time, you come to 677 BC. And it was the only thing that they could find that seemed to fit. But friends, the fact is, it doesn't fit. Now, this is not enough evidence. If this isn't enough evidence, let's examine the context of Leviticus 26 further. The four different seven times. What verses were they found in? 18, 21, 24, 28. The four different seven times, friends, are not concurrent. Notice the language. God begins by stating that if Israel will not obey, he will punish them seven times. Seven times, that's what the text says, but he'll punish them sevenfold, seven times, whatever you want to call it, for their sins. But going further, in verse 21, God says, "And if you walk contrary unto me, then he will bring seven times more plagues." Then God says, "If you will not be reformed by me by these things," in verse 23, he will punish them yet seven times for their sins. And finally, in verse 27 and 28, and we'll read it again, he says, "And if you will not for all this hearken unto me," you see these first three seven times, "if for all these you won't hearken unto me, but walk contrary to me, then I will walk contrary unto you also in fury, and I, even I, will chastise you seven times for your sins." Leviticus 26, verses 27 and 28. Now, friends, this language does not declare concurrent judgments, but rather successive punishments. If today's proponents of the 2520 were true to the context, then there would not be one so-called 2520 period, but there would be a total of four of them. Four 2520s, and that adds up to 10,080. If these were really symbolic, prophetic times, there should be 10,080 years that has to be accounted for. Furthermore, the curse upon Israel did not fall in 677 BC. But if it had, and if the seven times were a prophecy, then I have to ask you, what happened in 1844 that freed the Jewish people from the curse? Historically, what could we say happened then, or what could have happened in 1843, or any time around there that made something of significant difference that we could say, ah, this is the fulfillment of the prophecy? But friends, there is nothing. And if one claims, as some do, that the prophecy extended to spiritual Israel, from whom does such authority come to make this claim? In addition, if we were to say that this is now speaking of spiritual Israel, then what about the whole Protestant Reformation? It could have no bearing, because spiritual Israel was under bondage at that time and under a curse. And that, friends, is absurd. The fact is, and that's what we want, isn't it? The fact, the truth. We want the truth. The fact is, the Bible gives us information that there was indeed a curse upon the Jews while they were in captivity in Babylon and then in Persia. And Nehemiah recorded in his prayer in Nehemiah chapter 1 and verse 8, he says, "Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, If ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations." And Nehemiah was making reference to Leviticus 26, verse 33. And so he recognized in that a captivity. But in verse 9, Nehemiah makes reference to Leviticus 26, verses 39 through 42, where the possibility of return was given if the people returned to their God while they were in captivity. And of course, we know that God did take them back, didn't he? Remember, though, that Leviticus 26 is a conditional prophecy, and the conditions were still there after the captivity. And history documents that by AD 70, the rebellion of the Jewish people was such that God's wrath came upon them again in the destruction of Jerusalem. And if you don't think that met a fulfillment of this, then you need to read the first chapter of the book, The Great Controversy, because there Ellen White speaks about it. And in fact, I'm going to read you a reference later where Ellen White speaks about it again. But friends, that date, the date of AD 70, was not a date on a prophetic timeline. It was something that was going to happen, but there was no prophecy saying exactly when it was going to happen. Paul also wrote about the Jews and their cup being filled before the destruction of Jerusalem. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, he wrote, "Who both killed the Lord Jesus and their own prophets and have persecuted us, and they please not God and are contrary to all men, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved, to fill up their sins always, for the wrath to come upon them to the uttermost." Now I want to talk to you about some chart history. William Miller, Himes, Litch, French, and various Adventists prepared several prophetic charts prior to 1843. Now these charts are not the charts under discussion in this study, but rather the chart that was produced by Charles Fitch, published by Joshua Himes, and that was the chart that became the standard chart, the chart that is today known as the 1843 chart. As seen in the exhibit here, the 1843 chart, it has the calculation of the seven times in the upper right part of the chart, and some of the charts actually had the 2520, as you see in this in the black and white chart here in our slide, actually had the date of 2520 in larger numerals than 1843. No new chart was apparently made between 1843 and 1844. After they came to a realization that there was a mistake, they didn't produce a new chart. And Froom, in his book, The Prophetic Faith of Our Fathers, Volume 4, page 721, gives us the history. He says, "From this time, the summer of 1842, it continued to be the unchallenged standard portrayed until April 1844, up to the accepted close of the Jewish year, 1843. Only during the intensive seventh-month movement from July to October 1844 do we find no new charts employed. This was chiefly because there was no change of view on any major principle of prophetic interpretation, only the correction of the year or time phase from 1843 to 1844, as demanded by the computation of 2300 full years from the autumn of 457 BC to the autumn of AD 1844. Our next chart under consideration was published in 1850 by Otis Nichols and was designed by Samuel Rhodes. In the revised chart of 1850, the seven times of Leviticus 26 was retained, but it was not as prominently displayed as it had been in the 1843 chart. Instead, the seven times was put in much smaller letters in the bottom right corner of the chart. And this part, if you actually do the math, the part that deals with the 2520 actually comprises less than 1.4% of the chart. But the 2300 days, with the dates of 457 and 1844, are predominant. Those are the dates that are important. Those are the dates that have become important. Now, in 1863, a chart was prepared by James White and totally removed any reference to the 2520. And here we see the 18, what became known as the 1863 chart. This chart kept its focus upon the 2300 days with 457 and 1844 as the standout dates. This chart also placed an emphasis upon the holy and most holy places of the heavenly sanctuary. Now the matter, we're talking about some chart history, the matter in which the 1863 chart came into being is historically important. On May the 21st, 1863, something happened in Battle Creek, Michigan. Do you know what began on that date? The brethren met to form what would later become the Seventh-day Adventist General Conference. The denomination was being born, officially. And it is of interest to note that Uriah Smith wrote a short report about the unity and the atmosphere of the conference. And I want to quote a few of the paragraphs that Smith wrote. Notice what he says. "We can say to the readers of the review, think of everything good that has been written of every previous meeting and apply it to this. All this would be true, and more than this, perhaps no previous meeting that we have ever enjoyed was characterized by such unity of feeling and harmony of sentiment. In all the important steps taken at this conference, in the organization of a general conference and the further perfecting of state conference, defining the authority of each, and the important duties belonging to their various officers, there was not a dissenting voice, and we may reasonably doubt if there was even a dissenting thought. Such union on such points affords the strongest grounds of hope for the immediate advancement of the cause and its future glorious prosperity and triumph. The influence of this meeting cannot fail to be good. We are certain that those who were present, as they look back upon the occasion, will not be able to discover an unpleasant feature. And as they separated to go to their homes, courage and good cheer seemed to be the unanimous feelings." Now notice that Elder Smith said that there was no prior meeting that was characterized by such unity of feeling and harmony of sentiment. He said that there was not even a dissenting voice, and he had reason to believe there was not even a dissenting thought. He further stated that the future, as the believers looked back upon this conference, that in the future that they would not be able to discover an unpleasant feature. Now, besides organizing the General Conference, besides outlining an outline plan for the state conferences, there were two resolutions voted. And I want to show you what those resolutions were from the history of the Adventist Review as it was published. In May 26, 1863, voted that this conference recommend to the Publishing Association to publish a new prophetic chart. Voted that we recommend to the Publishing Association to publish a chart of the Ten Commandments suitable for public lectures. And they made two new charts. One being the 1863 prophetic chart, the other a chart of the Ten Commandments suitable for framing, suitable for public use. One proponent of the so-called 2520 prophecy opposes this 1863 chart because it removed the supposed seven times prophecy from it. And the following partial answer to this person's question was given in a publication of Jeff Pippinger's entitled Future News under Frequently Asked Questions, but it appears that a man by the name of Tyler was responding for Pippinger in this. And I have no problem with Tyler. I have no problem with Jeff Pippinger. We're not talking about people today. That's not the issue. This just happens to be who wrote it. Our issue is with the truth, right? We're not here against any brother. We love these brothers. We want them saved just as much as I hope they want us saved, right? Okay. Here's what he says. He says, the best defense against, now notice this is against, the 1863 chart is the silence of the spirit of prophecy in regard to its prophetic significance, whereas Sister White clearly identified the 1843 and 1850 charts as Habakkuk's tables. Ellen White was not silent about this chart. In fact, if you get Volume 1 of the Testimonies off your shelf, on page 689, and this was written in 1868, we find these words. She's writing to people who need our literature, our believers who need literature. And some of these people were poor. And she said, "And we would say to those who are poor and want books, send in your orders with a statement of your condition as to this world's goods. We will send you a package of books containing four volumes of Spiritual Gifts, How to Live, Appeal to Youth, appeal to mothers, Sabbath readings, and two large charts. No, she doesn't say two large charts. The two large charts with Key of Explanation. Key of Explanation, you notice, is italicized. It was a publication of itself. She says, the two large charts. And these were the only two large charts, friends, that they had. And she was promoting them in her writings to the believers. Now, I want to just bring in another statement from the testimonies, because I believe it has a bearing, not only in this particular subject we're talking about, but other subjects that are equally important to us, or perhaps, I hope, greater. And this is from Volume 4 of the Testimonies, page 595, and it was written in 1881. It is as certain that we have the truth as that God lives, and Satan, with all his arts and hellish power, cannot change the truth of God into a lie. While the great adversary will try his utmost to make of none effect the word of God, truth must go forth as a lamp that burneth. Now, in 1881, Ellen White boldly declared that she and the other Adventists had the truth as sure as God lives. How do I know that she was included in this? Because of the wording. Notice she says it is as certain that we have the truth. She was speaking about herself and the rest of the people. And if this seven times of 2520 was a true major prophecy, and one of such extent that it's a separation issue, one of such an extent that it's going to cause us to be lost and miss the latter rain if we don't accept it, why would she make this statement? She really couldn't, friends. She couldn't. Beloved, you can search every list of fundamentals ever published by the Advent people, and you will find no mention of a so-called 2520 prophecy in any of them. If this prophecy were the so-called testing truth today that some declare it to be, then Ellen White made a mistake in 1881. No. No, she didn't make a mistake at all, friends, on the issue of the seven times. And she did not make a mistake in 1881 also about the so-called doctrine of the Trinity either, did she? One can do an exhaustive computer search of the Ellen White database of writings, and you know what? You will never, ever find one mentioned of the 2520. You never find the numerals 2520 in the database. You never find her writing about it. And in fact, there's only one place in all her writings that she even mentions the seven times of Leviticus 26. And it was in previously all the unpublished writings. Hadn't been published until they just released the whole database a year or two ago. And there we find in a manuscript these words that she wrote. And I'm going to read you a lot, because I want you to make sure that you know that I'm reading this in context and I'm not taking something out of place here. Okay? It's not a bait-and-switch thing, friends. We're looking at the real deal. Here's what she said. God specified also the sure result of a disregard for his commandments. If you will not hearken unto me, he said, and will not do all these commandments, I also will do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, and burning ague, that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart, and ye shall sow your seed in vain, and your enemies shall eat it, and I will set my face against you, for ye shall be slain by your enemies. Does this sound familiar? Let's go on. They that hate you shall reign over you, and ye shall flee when none pursueth you, and if ye will not yet for all this hearken unto me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins, and I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass, and your strength shall be spent in vain, for your land shall not yield her increase, neither shall the trees of the land yield their fruits. And again, she's quoting right from Leviticus 26, but this is the only time she uses this expression seven times from Leviticus 26. But I want to read on some more of the context, because you're going to see how it fits exactly with something that we said earlier. It shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and statutes, which I command you this day, that all these curses shall come unto thee and overtake thee. Cursed shalt thou be in the city, and cursed shalt thou be in the field. Cursed shall be thy basket and thy store. Cursed shall be the fruit of the body and the fruit of the land, the increase of thy kind and the flocks of thy sheep. Cursed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and cursed shalt thou be when thou goest out. This is the result of disobedience and transgression. let all read carefully the 28th chapter of Deuteronomy, realizing that it makes every difference to a people whether they are obedient or disobedient to the law of Jehovah. The prophecies regarding Israel were fulfilled to the letter. God permitted his chosen people to be scattered as captives in strange lands. When they repented, God took them to himself again and established them in his own land, but their continual disobedience resulted in their complete overthrow and in the overthrow of Jerusalem. Do you remember earlier I made reference to you from Nehemiah chapter 1? In verse 8 where Nehemiah is praying and he's making reference to Leviticus 26. But then he said, but there's hope. If we will return to you, you'll bring us out of this captivity. And Ellen White is saying that's exactly what happened. And just as I mentioned to you, because it was a conditional prophecy and things could still move on in a different way, God, and by the time of AD 70, the cup of transgression for that nation as a group was so full that he brought the destruction of Jerusalem upon them as a people. And that's exactly what Ellen White is saying here also. Friends, mark this point with care. Ellen White makes no reference to the seven times being a symbolic time prophecy, and she further notes, as we did discuss earlier when discussing Leviticus 26, that God did indeed scatter the people, but when they repented, God took them to himself and established them in his own land. Further, because of further disobedience, Jerusalem was overthrown. Now, unlike the 2520, Ellen White mentions the 2300 days or years of Daniel 8:14 many times in statements such as, the scripture, which above all others had been both the foundation and the central pillar of the Advent faith, was the declaration unto 2300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed, Daniel 8:14. And that's from Great Controversy, page 409. You know that statement. It's a famous statement. She specifically mentions, though, also the dates 457 and 1844 in relationship to the 2300 days. Here we have reading in also Great Controversy, page 410. She says, the 2300 days had been found to begin when the commandment of Artaxerxes for the restoration and building of Jerusalem went into effect in the autumn of 457 BC. Taking this as the starting point, there was perfect harmony in the application of all the events foretold in the explanation of that period in Daniel 9, 25 through 27. 69 weeks, the first 483 of the 2300 years, were to reach to the Messiah, the Anointed One, and Christ's baptism and anointing by the Holy Spirit, AD 27, exactly fulfilled the specification. In the midst of the 70th week, Messiah was to be cut off. 3.5 years after his baptism, Christ was crucified in the spring of AD 31. The 70 weeks, or 490 years, were to pertain especially to the Jews. At the expiration of this period, the nation sealed its rejection of Christ by the persecution of his disciples, and the apostles turned to the Gentiles, AD 34. The first 490 years of the 2300 having then ended, 1810 years would remain from AD 34, 1810 years extended to 1844. That's Great Controversy 410. I know you've read that before, but I'm just wanting you to see the evidence and the fact that Ellen White, in more than one place, and in fact, there are hundreds of references in her writings to the 2300 days, hundreds of references, but not a single one to this 2520. But also, in Great Controversy, she also spoke of the 70 weeks, and she provided the dates. Ellen White wrote of the 1260 years, also known as the 42 months. In our next slide here, we have from Great Controversy, page 266. The period here mentioned, 42 months and 1,203 score days, are the same, alike representing the time in which the Church of Christ was to suffer oppression from Rome. The 1,260 years of papal supremacy began in AD 538 and would therefore terminate in 1798. So these things that we count as so being so important, these things that were on the 1863 chart, Ellen White over and over speaks about. Ellen White also spoke of the beasts of Daniel 7. She said in the book Education, page 177, prophecy has traced the rise and fall of the world's great empires. What are they? Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. With each of these, as with nations of less power, history repeated itself. Each had its period of test, each failed, its glory faded, its power departed, and its place was occupied by another. And so as we study, if you will do a study and search through Ellen White's writings, you'll find that she clearly substantiates and agrees with the prophetic messages that our people have been preaching for many years now. But despite repeatedly speaking so clear on major prophetic events, the same events that were on this 1863 chart, Ellen White never spoke of this so-called 2520 and never attempted to give clear beginning or ending times for it. Now I want to talk about some pioneer history on Leviticus 26. We've given you a little bit of this, but I want to give you some more. And the reason I'm wanting to give you more, and I'm going to give you some more on some other things, beloved, is because, again, there are people who are counting this right now as a life or death issue. They are hinging their salvation on this. And, beloved, as we mentioned not long ago, that when you begin to put your salvation on simply a belief instead of on Christ, you have found another gospel. And that's why I'm being difficult about this. That's why I'm saying so much about this, because it's that important. Now, as we noted earlier, after the disappointment of 1844, the early Adventists, including James White, continued to support the idea that the seven times of Leviticus 26 was a prophecy of 2,520 years. Due to careful biblical study and because of the honest nature of their hearts, this concept, though, that the seven times of Leviticus 26, this concept of the 2520, was dropped by 1860. During the decade between 1850 and 1860, four different writers in the Review and Herald wrote supporting the 2520. James White himself wrote supporting it. Joseph Bates wrote. Hiram Edson, and then there was another unnamed writer, wrote in the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald supporting this concept of 2520 as a prophecy. But by January 1864, James White wrote positively against the view that the seven times of Leviticus 26 was a symbolic prophecy. He began by stating this: "The prophetic period of Leviticus 26, or what has been supposed to be such, has been no small object of study among prophetic expositors. It has been supposed that the expression seven times in verses 18, 21, 24, 28 denoted a prophetic period of 2,520 years, and that this period covered the time during which the throne of Israel should be and remain subverted and trodden down by oppressing powers. To rightly fix the commencement and termination of this period became therefore a matter of consequence. Where does it commence and where does it end have been questions of much study and perhaps some perplexity." Notice his simple reply. These are not the questions, however, that we propose here to discuss, for there is a question lying back of these which demands to be answered first. Namely, is there any prophetic period brought to view at all in Leviticus 26? We claim that there is not. And Elder White didn't say, "I claim there's not." He says, "We claim." Those people involved with the Publishing Association and Review, they did not see this as being biblical. After doing, then, a biblical examination of the text, he concluded by noting this: "So then, there is no prophetic period in Leviticus 26, and those who imagine that such a thing exists and are puzzling themselves over the adjustment of its several dates are simply beating the air. To ignore or treat with neglect a prophetic period where one is plainly given is censurable in the extreme. It is an equally futile, though not so heinous, a course to endeavor to create one where none exists." That's what Elder White wrote in 1864. Writing in April of the first edition of the Review and Herald in 1880, Elder White began and brought the matter again, and he noted, "Some writers on chronology have had not a little to say, first and last, on a supposed prophetic period which they introduce under the name of the seven times and interpret to mean a period of 2,520 years. Marvelous is the arithmetic and historical juggery then resorted to find a starting point and an ending place for this important and far-reaching period." And may I just say that Elder White himself had published an article himself earlier, years before. And so he was honest enough to say, I was mistaken. I was mistaken. But after giving a short explanation on the matter, he closed that article by stating this. It strikes us that it would be far better for people to spend their strength in trying to ascertain the correct application of the prophetic periods that are given in the Bible, rather than figure so laboriously to find a place to begin and end those which are not. Now in 1887, Uriah Smith, in an article in the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald entitled Prophetic Confusion, he examined a study by a man listed simply as M. Baxter, an article he had written in the Christian Herald and Signs of Our Times, and that was not a Seventh-day Adventist publication. But Smith, in writing, is blunt. He states, in the first place, he introduces a period of seven times, or 2,500 years, dates them from 620 before Christ and ends them in 1900 after Christ. One great trouble with this part of the program is that there is no such period as seven times, or 2,520 years, brought to view in all the Scriptures. Uriah Smith would continue to write against this so-called 2520 in the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald issues of March 10, 1891, July 28, 1891, July 2, 1895, January 27, 1903, and also in his famous book, Thoughts on Daniel and Revelation, in Appendix Number 2, he also writes against the 2520. And all these are in the paper. You can look the references up. These papers are published at the church archives. Everyone who has access to the internet can have these papers and study and see if these things were actually said. Now I'll ask a question. This is a fundamental question. Was this so-called 2520 prophecy ever a landmark or pillar among the Advent people? Today, some are declaring that the so-called 2520 prophecy is a landmark or a pillar of our faith. An illogical attempt is made to declare that the message, now listen to this carefully, that the message of 1840 through 1844 is the foundation of Adventism. But beloved, the message of 1840 through 1844 did not include the Sabbath. It did not understand the state of the dead, nor the truth about God, and neither did it have the correct understanding of the sanctuary. And friends, that cannot be the foundation of our faith today. But let's let inspiration speak, without circular reasoning or illogic, and declare what the foundation of the Advent movement was and still is today. And we, I believe, read this statement earlier, but I'll read it again. It's from Great Controversy, page 409. And there Ellen White says, the scripture which above all others had been both the foundation and the central pillar of the Advent faith was the declaration unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Great Controversy, 409. But Brother Allen, didn't you just say that the Millerites preached Daniel 8:14 and they preached it from 1840 through 1844, so shouldn't that message that they preached be the foundation of our faith because they preached about the sanctuary? But I want you to notice something else that Ellen White says. This is from a letter written in 1906. It's been published in the book Evangelism, page 221. The correct understanding of the ministration in the heavenly sanctuary is the foundation of our faith. It's not just simply saying that I believe a sanctuary doctrine, because you know what? There's people like Desmond Ford. He has a belief about a sanctuary doctrine, right? And there are others who have a belief about a sanctuary doctrine. But is it the correct understanding? Of course not. She says it has to be the correct understanding. Miller and his associates used Daniel 8:14 extensively, yet they did not have the correct understanding of the heavenly sanctuary. And the correct understanding of that scripture did come after the 1844 disappointment. And Ellen White helps us to understand more of the landmarks and pillars. And you're familiar with this reference. I'll go through it quickly, but we need to make sure that we know what we're talking about, that we're not taking suppositions. You don't take my word for something. We're looking at what inspiration says here, friends. In Counsels to Writers and Editors on pages 30 and 31, she writes, the passing of the time in 1844 was a period of great events, opening to our astonished eyes the cleansing of the sanctuary transpiring in heaven and having decided relation to God's people upon the earth. Also the first and second angels' messages, and the third, unfurling the banner on which is inscribed the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. One of the landmarks under this message was the temple of God seen by his truth-loving people in heaven, and the ark containing the law of God. The light of the Sabbath of the fourth commandment flashed its strong rays in the pathway of the transgressor of God's law. The non-immortality of the wicked is an old landmark. And in this reference, Ellen White mentions the sanctuary, the three angels' messages, the law of God including the Sabbath, the faith of Jesus, and the non-immortality of the wicked. And to this, we can add another doctrine which is usually overlooked, but revealed in a statement that Ellen White wrote on May 24, 1905. And this statement directly addresses the situation of the false teachings of Elder A.F. Ballinger. Do you remember Ballinger? Ballinger, he had some views on salvation and sanctification that were very wrong. And Ellen White wrote to him. She says, "Those who seek to remove the old landmarks are not holding fast. They are not remembering how they have received and heard. Those who try to bring in theories that would remove the pillars of our faith concerning the sanctuary or concerning the personality of God or of Christ are working as blind men. They are seeking to bring in uncertainties and to set the people of God adrift without an anchor." She says that these landmarks and pillars are anchors, friends. She also later defines the spirit of prophecy as one of those anchors in Volume 1 of the Testimonies, page 300. But 2 years before this statement, Ellen White noted, "The warning has come. Nothing is to be allowed to come in that will disturb the foundation of the faith upon which we have been building ever since the message came in 1842, 1843, and 1844. I was in this message, and ever since I have been standing before the world true to the light that God has given us. We do not propose to take our feet off the platform on which they were placed as day by day we sought the Lord with earnest prayer, seeking for light. Do you think that I could give up the light that God has given me? It is to be as the rock of ages. It has been guiding me ever since it was given." It was spoken at the General Conference of 1903. And you know that about this time, something else was happening in the denomination. What was it? John Harvey Kellogg and the Living Temple. Ellen White says that she held firmly to the foundation. And when Ballinger began to teach strange doctrines on the sanctuary and on salvation and sanctification, Ellen White sounded the warning. When Dr. Kellogg began to teach what would become the alpha of deadly heresies, Ellen White spoke out. And today, we are now led to believe, by the proponents of this 2520 prophecy, that Elder James White, Uriah Smith, Jane Loughborough, Jane Andrews, and others were all in some kind of a great apostasy over denying the 2520 prophecy. Yet, there is never one word of rebuke from Ellen White. She spoke when Kellogg jumped to the scene. She spoke about Ballinger. She spoke about Canright and others. But she never once brings this up in her writings, ever. And yet she said she stood for the truth and she defended the truth. It's amazing, friends, that such an idea could be considered. Such an idea that Ellen White failed to speak is not from heaven, but rather from the pit of hell, friends. Now, we're going to soon see more testimonies of the pioneers that totally contradict the 2520. But before we do, I need to look at some objections. Because those people who hold on to this prophecy, they will have certain objections, and they're going to be based upon certain statements, and we need to look at those too. I mean, really, if we just look at what the Bible says, the short expose we did on the Bible, looking at what the words said, what were there, what actually weren't there, looking at the grammar of the words, that should have been enough of itself. But there's more, and we're going to look at more here. But we've looked at the biblical and the historical understanding of Leviticus 26. And in doing that, we have followed the Protestant teaching of sola scriptura, a teaching fully endorsed by Ellen White. She said in Great Controversy, page 595, "But God will have a people upon the earth to maintain the Bible and the Bible only as the standard of all doctrines and the basis of all reforms." I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, okay, that's Ellen's excuse to get rid of some of Ellen White's statements now. He's going to quote that one and say, we just have to go by the Bible, but we're not going to look at these other statements of Ellen White's. Not at all. Not at all. There are those who, like us, firmly believe that the scriptures and the testimony of Ellen White agree. But these people, these proponents of this doctrine, also believe that the testimonies speak differently from what we have seen the Bible clearly teaches on this subject. And so in an effort to keep from denying the testimonies of Ellen White, they've had to come up with a different understanding of Leviticus 26 in order to maintain their belief. Now, what is it about the testimonies of Ellen White that cause this difference? It mostly concerns one point, Ellen White's endorsement of Fitch's 1843 chart. And here are some of her statements, and we're going to look at them. We're not going to avoid any of them. She says, as early as 1842, the direction given in this prophecy to write the vision and make it plain upon tables that he may run that readeth it has suggested to Charles Fitch the preparation of a prophetic chart to illustrate the visions of Daniel and the Revelation. The publication of this chart was regarded as a fulfillment of the command given by Habakkuk. No one, however, then noticed that an apparent delay in the accomplishment of the vision, a tarrying time, is presented in the same prophecy. After the disappointment, this scripture appeared very significant. The vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. The just shall live by his faith. And that's from Great Controversy, page 382. But it's not all she said. In early writings, on page 74, I have seen that the 1840, and by the way, when she says, I have seen, what does that mean? She's had heavenly instruction, right? She says, I have seen that the 1843 chart was directed by the hand of the Lord, and that it should not be altered, that the figures were as he wanted them, and that his hand was over, and hid a mistake in some of the figures so that none could see it until his hand was removed. And then in Spalding and McGann collection, page 1, I saw that the truth should be made plain upon tables, that the earth and the fullness thereof is the Lord's, and that necessary means should not be spared to make it plain. I saw that the old chart was directed by the Lord, and that not a figure of it should be altered except by what?
Inspiration.
I saw that the figures of the chart were as God would have them, and that his hand was over and hid a mistake in some of the figures so that none could see it till his hand was removed. Now let's notice, friends, some vital points from these statements. First, in our statement from the Great Controversy, Ellen White stated that the prophetic charts were considered by the brethren preaching the Advent message to be a fulfillment of Habakkuk chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. In early writings, Ellen White plainly admitted that there was a mistake in some of the figures, but that this was as God directed it so that there could be a testing time. During this tarrying time, there'd be a testing time. And then in the Spalding McGann statement, Ellen White states that the chart should not be changed except by what? Inspiration. And friends, the issue comes down to this. Did Ellen White give the whole 1843 chart a blank check endorsement? And would she only agree to change that which God showed her by inspiration? And I believe the answer to both parts of this question is no. I'm going to clearly show you why it must be a decided no. Let's begin with the issue of inspiration. When Ellen White wrote that it should only be changed by inspiration, she was not restricting change to only that which she would be shown in a vision or in a dream. How do I know this? I know this because of the way Ellen White herself used this concept or explained this concept of inspiration. I want you to notice some statements from her own pen. This first one is from Patriarchs and Prophets, page 45. The genealogy of our race, as given by inspiration, traces back its origin to the great Creator. Though formed from the dust, Adam was the Son of God. She says inspiration gives us the origin of our race. What does she mean when she says inspiration? She says the Bible. The teaching of the Bible does this. Here's another statement, also from Patriarchs and Prophets, page 238. Inspiration faithfully records the faults of good men, those who were distinguished by the favor of God. Indeed, their faults are more fully presented than their virtues. What inspiration does that? The Bible. Here again, she equates inspiration to the teachings of the Bible. And here are some more examples. Desire of Ages, page 558. Inspiration declares, the dead know not anything. Their love and their hatred and their envy is now perished, Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verses 5 and 6. She says that this text is inspiration. Also, in Prophets and Kings, page 323, she quotes Proverbs 21, verse 27, and she says, inspiration declares, the sacrifice of the wicked is abomination, how much more when he bringeth it with a wicked mind. She's equating this text in Proverbs with what? Inspiration. And then in the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald, she does this again. She says, inspiration declares that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Inspiration from the Word of God, friends, taught the Advent believers to change the ending date of the 2300 days to 1844 in the 1850 chart. And before Ellen White even had her first vision, the Millerites knew that 1843 was wrong for the ending point of the 2300 days, and they presented 1844 as the correct date. And how did they know this? It's because they studied inspiration. Ellen White says in Early Writings, page 236, those faithful, disappointed ones who could not understand why their Lord did not come were not left in darkness. Again, they were led to their Bible to search the prophetic periods, and the hand of the Lord was removed from the figures, and the mistake was explained. Now, the inspiration of the Bible helped the believers move from 1843 to 1844. But inspiration wasn't finished. Through positively sound exegetical study of the Bible, Elder James White did not include the 2520 prophecy, so-called prophecy, on the chart that he produced in 1863. Now, next we need to consider what could be changed. Did not Sister White speak of a mistake, singular, in some of the figures, plural? This has led the proponents, or some of the proponents, of the so-called 2520 to teach that the mistake, singular, was in the fact that they included a 0 year between 1 BC and 1 AD. And the figures, plural, were the two different 1843s on the chart, one for the 2300 days and one for the 2520. However, this is restricting the language beyond what is necessary. It certainly could mean that there was one mistake upon which to focus, or it could mean that there was more than one mistake in total, but only one problem upon which to focus. And I know I've done this so many times as an educator. I'd be going by a student's desk and I'd see several problems. And there were many that were wrong. But I would point to one and say, there's a mistake here, referring, focusing on a certain point, a mistake here. Or in doing a whole long problem that would require a long algorithm. And maybe there were several mistakes because there's a mistake up here at the beginning. I say, there's a mistake. And I don't say there's many mistakes. I don't need to do that. Furthermore, and I know this mathematically, when one speaks mathematically, the term figures can mean one, two, or all the numbers in a computation collectively. It should also be noted that Miller used the time period between the dates of 158 BC and 508 AD to add up to, what would that add up to? The way he computed it, it added up to 666. Revelation 13:18, which he declared to be the time of pagan Rome's dominion, but this is not accepted today. Revelation 13:18 describes the number of a man, not the length of the beast's dominion. Friends, God certainly did direct the making of the 1843 chart. There's no question about that. His hand was over it for a time. It is also clear that he removed his hand from the error or errors that previously had resulted in the date 1843 being on the chart. Now, there's another issue, and I hate to bring up so many of these issues because they probably don't even come to your mind. But to some people's minds, they've been an issue, and we have to make sure that we have an explanation. Is that fair? This concept of prophetic periods. Another Ellen White statement that the proponents of the so-called 2520 prophecy used to support their cause is found in Early Writings on page 236. They saw that the prophetic periods, notice that's plural, the prophetic periods reached to 1844, and that the same evidence which they had presented to show that the prophetic periods closed in 1843 proved that they would terminate in 1844. And to the proponents of this so-called 2520 prophecy, the phrase prophetic periods, plural, means the 2520 and the 2300 years. In fact, no matter what she wrote about, she never wrote about the 2520. She does mention over and over, though, the 70 weeks of Daniel 9 and the 2300 days of Daniel 8. And when we begin to read these statements in their context, and to combine them with other statements, we can be sure that Ellen White was not making reference to the 2520. And I noticed in reading some of the proponents' material that they would quote from Ellen White, and I'm going to read you some of these quotes, where Ellen White was talking about the prophetic periods, and she mentions the 70 weeks, she mentions the 2300 days, but she never mentions the 2520. But then they take what she says totally out of the context of what she said, and they say, see, it must mean 2520. Well, let's read on a statement here. And this is from Early Writings, page 235. The preaching of definite time called forth great opposition from all classes, from the minister in the pulpit down to the most reckless, heaven-daring sinner. No man knoweth the day nor the hour was heard from the hypocritical minister and the bold scoffer. Neither would be instructed and corrected by those who were pointing to the year when they believed the prophetic periods would run out, and to the signs which showed Christ near even at the doors. So I'm only speaking about prophetic periods, plural. No problem. She says that. But notice also in Early Writings, page 237, the believers in this message were opposed in the churches. For a time, those who would not receive the message were restrained by fear from acting out the sentiments of their hearts, but the passing of time revealed their true feelings. They wished to silence the testimony which the waiting ones felt compelled to bear. Now, it should be clear that Ellen White is making reference above in these statements to the prophetic periods of 1260 and 2300 years as a unit when she says the prophetic periods extended to 1844. She says this is true of the 2300 day or year prophecy because it's also the longest prophecy of the Bible. Now, notice and I think I have it here in emphasis so you can see it. She's speaking about two prophetic periods in this statement from Great Controversy, page 326. And notice what periods that she's talking about in the statement. The context, right? We want the context. It's important. Context is not higher criticism. In fact, one of the proponents of the 2520 says you can only understand Leviticus 26 in the context of Leviticus 25. Okay? So context is not wrong. 70 weeks, representing 490 years, are declared by the angel to be cut off, especially pertaining to the Jews. But from what were they cut off? As the 2300 days was the only period of time mentioned in chapter 8, it must be the period from which the 70 weeks were cut off. The 70 weeks must therefore be a part of the 2300 days, and the two periods must begin together. What two periods is she talking about that begin together? The 70 weeks and the 2300 days. No one agrees that the 2520 and the 2300 begin together. But notice she calls these two, even though they work as one, two prophetic periods. She continues, the 70 weeks were declared by the angel to date from the going forth of the commandment to restore and build Jerusalem. If the date of this commandment could be found, then the starting point for the great period of the 2300 days would be ascertained. And that's from Great Controversy, page 326. Notice again, she speaks of two periods, the 70 weeks and the 2300 days. And there's not a need to have a 2520 so that you have periods plural, because Ellen White applies the periods to the 2300 days and the 70 weeks both together. Notice also again from Great Controversy, page 351. The experience of the disciples who preached the gospel of the kingdom at the first advent of Christ had its counterpart in the experience of those who proclaimed the message of his second advent. As the disciples went out preaching, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, so Miller and his associates proclaimed that the longest and last prophetic period brought to view in the Bible was about to expire, that your judgment was at hand, and the everlasting kingdom was to be ushered in. The preaching of the disciples in regard to time was based on the 70 weeks of Daniel 9. The message given by Miller and his associates announced the termination of the 2300 days of Daniel 8:14, of which the 70 weeks form a part. The preaching of each was based upon the fulfillment of a different portion of the same great prophetic period. Now, Ellen White says that they preached the longest time prophecy in the Bible, and what time prophecy does she mention in the context? The 2300 days. Now, it should be noted that at this time that Joshua Himes and these men were preaching, they themselves did not consider the 2300 days to be the longest. They thought the 2520 was. Ellen White doesn't say they were preaching what they thought was the longest time prophecy. She was saying they were preaching what was the longest time prophecy, and she says that longest time prophecy was the 2300 days. Now let's suppose that I am a nominal Christian, or even a non-believer, but someone gives me the book, The Great Controversy, to read, okay? This is the book above all books except the Bible. And in reading it, I'm going to learn about the 2300 days. I'm going to learn about the 1260. But you know what I will never read about in that book? I'll never read about the 2520. How can this person, how could I be expected to learn of the 2520 unless I have someone else's materials? Now I need something else other than the Bible or the Spirit of Prophecy. I need someone else's material that will explain this 2520 because Ellen White never does it. You see, and my salvation, my receiving the latter rain, is going to be jeopardized if I only have the Spirit of Prophecy in the Bible. Friends, that cannot be. Yes, you know, I've written a large book called The Foundation of Our Faith on this truth about God. But friends, you don't have to have my book to come to this conclusion. You don't have to have my book to know the truth. It's all in the Bible and the Spirit of Prophecy already. I want to tell you, the Great Controversy is lacking nothing. It is a special book for this time, and God is fair and has provided people just what they need for this time. And the 2300-day prophecy is the longest time prophecy of the Bible. Now, just to be clear, by at least 1842, William Miller and Joshua Himes did not believe the 2300-day prophecy was the longest prophecy of the Bible. They believed the 2520 was the longest prophecy in the Bible. And there is evidence that in 1833, Miller viewed the 2300 days as the longest prophecy. And I give a reference for that in the footnotes of the paper. But he later replaced it with the 2520. And notice what Joshua Himes wrote. And I'm going to read you a couple statements by Himes. Himes wrote, and this is from the Advent Herald and Signs of the Times reporter, September 25, 1844, really close to that final October 22 date. He says that the longest prophetic period which brings the end to view, the seven times with which we may suppose all the others would be squared in their termination, ends with this autumn, appears very evident that we are in the last of the last year of the 2300 is still more evident, and the whole aspect of the world around us morally and politically agrees very well with the inspired portrait of the time of harvest. Then Himes also wrote in the Signs of the Times and Expositor of Prophecy on January 10, 1844, earlier in the year, he says, if the longest period was to be paramount, the seven times would take precedence of all others. And so Himes believed that the 2520 was the longest time prophecy. He says the seven times was the longest and one by which all others must be squared or measured. And if the length was paramount, the seven times would take precedence of all others. Now, there's no direct statement from Miller, but Himes was perhaps his closest working associate, and it would be hard to believe that Miller saw matters differently. But as we noted from Great Controversy, page 351, the context demands Ellen White to be speaking of the 2300 days as the longest time prophecy of the Bible, but she also confirmed this in another place. And by the way, before I read the next statement, you don't have to be very astute in mathematics to decide which number is greater. 2300 or 2520, right? Remember when you were in school, you'd do mathematics and you'd have two numbers and you had to put the greater than, less than, or equal to symbol in? And we all know that as far as a number value, 2520 is larger than 2300. But Ellen White says the 2300 days is the longest time prophecy of the Bible. If it is, then the 2520 can't be a prophecy, friends. That's true. Mathematics is clear. Ellen White said this, and this is in Manuscript Release, Volume 1, page 100. The longest reckoning of prophetic time reaches to the autumn of 1844. Now, that's not Miller. That's not Himes. That's an inspired statement. And it says it reaches to when? The autumn of 1844. All agree that the prophecy of Daniel 8:14 extends to the autumn of 1844. But did the so-called 2520 also extend to the autumn of 1844? As we have seen, if we accept the 2520 and we accept its date of 677 BC with the supposed captivity of Manasseh, This date from Manasseh's captivity is not historically sustainable. But furthermore, again, we'll give them the reason of the doubt. Suppose that Manasseh's captivity in 677 was an accurate time. It most likely could not have happened in the autumn of that year, because according to 2 Samuel chapter 11 and verse 1, spring was the time when kings went to war. They didn't go later. They went early in the spring when roads were passable. They didn't wait. Sister White, friends, clearly believed that the 2300 days of Daniel 8:14 was the longest time prophecy in the Bible. Now, I mentioned earlier a little bit of pioneer history, and I said we'd come back for some more supporting evidence, and I just want to give you a little bit more as we wind down. Outside of Elder White, it would be difficult to find two men more loyal to the truth and more zealous for upholding the gift of the spirit of prophecy in Ellen White than Stephen Haskell and J.N. Loughborough. If you know the history of Loughborough and Haskell, these men were devoted to the work of Ellen White. They were men who had been with her in the work from this very inception, and they would never have taught or published something that they believed Ellen White was against. Notice what they had to say about the longest time prophecy of the Bible. J.N. Loughborough, in his Heavenly Visions, states, "The 2300 days is the longest prophetic period, coming down a little past the termination of all others." And then, in Stephen Haskell's Bible Handbook, he says, "Daniel is the only little book that gives the 2300 days, the longest prophetic period in the Bible, which ended in 1844. Uriah Smith declared the 2300 days to be the longest time prophecy in his Thoughts on Daniel and Revelation on page 57 in the 1897 edition. He says, "This was the first installment of the great decree for the restoration and building again of Jerusalem, Ezra 6:14, which was completed in the seventh year of the reign of Artaxerxes, B.C. 457, and marked, as will hereafter be shown, the commencement of the 2300 days of Daniel 8, the longest and most important prophetic period mentioned in the Bible." Smith did not think the 2520 was the longest, and neither did he think that it was paramount over all others. Others clearly stated specifically that they believed the 2300 days to be the longest time prophecy in the Bible. Have you ever heard of E.J. Wagoner? Of 1888, Wagoner said, and this is from the Present Truth United Kingdom version of January 24, 1901. "In 1844, the longest and last period of time mentioned in prophecy expired. It was the 2,300 days of Daniel 8 and 9. Wagoner agrees, and there are other testimonies that are footnoted for you in the paper. Now, there's another point, though, that is brought up by the proponents of the 2520 that I think we should cover, and we can do it very quickly. And that is that there should be a second witness to sustain the 2300 days. And the second witness is the 2520 prophecy. And they base this upon a text in Deuteronomy, and here's the text, Deuteronomy 17:6, and it says, "At the mouth of two witnesses or three witnesses shall he that is worthy of death be put to death, but at the mouth of one witness he shall not be put to death." Now this text is referenced later by Jesus in Matthew 18:16, and is used by some to justify the need for the 2520 to support the 2300 days ending in 1844. But it should be noted that according to the context, Deuteronomy 17:6 was to be applied to civil cases and not prophetic timelines. And neither Jesus nor Paul, who also quotes Deuteronomy 17:6, applies it to any kind of a prophetic situation. And we believe that Daniel 8:14, though, is strong enough to stand on its own. I don't think it's a weak prophecy. But however, again, trying to bend over backwards toward this, if we accept the need for a second witness, friends, we don't need the 2520, because we have it in the very words of Jesus. As he began his ministry, he said, as recorded in Mark 1:15, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel." Friends, what time was fulfilled? The 69th week of the 70-week prophecy, an indivisible part of the 2300 days. And the Apostle Paul agrees in Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4. He says, "But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law." And here Paul is also clearly making reference and connection to Daniel. Also, The disappointment of the Advent people and their prophesying again is detailed in Revelation chapter 10. And their work of proclaiming the judgment hour message is laid out in Revelation 14. And these are sufficient plenty to substantiate Daniel 8:14 and the date 1844. Stephen Wahlberg had noted, and he says this, "The fact is that from 1863 until today, Adventist evangelists haven't needed the 2520 to validate either the 2300-year prophecy or the Advent movement in general." What he's saying is we've been telling this to people for years and years, and it's worked pretty good. Now I want to look at just some further thoughts on Ellen White's endorsement of William Miller and the fact that she says he was guided by an angel. Ellen White wrote concerning William Miller this: "God sent his angel to move upon the heart of a farmer who had not believed the Bible, to lead him to search the prophecies. Angels of God repeatedly visited that chosen one to guide his mind and open to his understanding prophecies which had ever been dark to God's people. The commencement of the chain of truth was given to him, and he was led on to search for link after link until he looked with wonder and admiration upon the Word of God. He saw the perfect chain of truth." Early Writings 2:29. This language is strong, very strong. God sent his angel. She noted that angels of God repeatedly visited Miller, leading him. And some have elevated this, friends, to be on par with the spirit of prophecy or even the Bible. But is this warranted? If the 2520 was one of the most important things that Miller wrote about, again, why did Ellen White never once directly or indirectly mention it in connection with Miller? She spoke of Miller's study of the 2300 days, but not once of his study of the 2520. May I remind you that William Miller was a Sunday keeper and a Trinitarian till the day he died, and he did not understand the truth about the heavenly sanctuary. He did not have all the light on even the major points, friends. He was guided in what he did. Angels helped him, but that doesn't mean that he became infallible because of that. And the fact is, Ellen White acknowledged that God used angels, even sent his angel to help Miller. But she says this about others too, who did not always speak all the truth. For example, Ellen White wrote about Martin Luther: "Angels of heaven were by his side, and rays of light from the throne of God revealed the treasures of truth to his understanding. He had ever feared to offend God, but now the deep conviction of his condition as a sinner took hold upon him as never before." Is that really any less strong than what she wrote about Miller? Yet to his death, Luther, like Miller, was also a Trinitarian and a Sunday keeper. Luther also believed in transubstantiation until he died, and he was actively involved in persecuting Sabbath keepers, even to their death, if possible. Luther was not bashful of drinking alcohol and making merry in the pubs at night, but Ellen White still called him a man for his time. Ellen White wrote also that angels of God guided her husband, James White, and had oversight of the review. She said, "I saw that the papers," referring to the papers of the Review and Herald, "would go, and that it would be the means of bringing souls to a knowledge of truth. I saw," one of those "I saw" statements again, in it. "I saw that James had not borne the burden alone, but that Uriah Smith and Jane Andrews helped him." Is that what the statement says? "I saw that James had not borne the burden alone, but that the angels of God had assisted and had oversight of the paper." Not only helping James White, but oversight of the paper. But friends, she never said that everything Elder White said was impeccable, and she never gave the paper, the status of the papal ex cathedra. You speak it in the chair, it's true. Hardly. Ellen White also wrote very positively of Uriah Smith's book and his work, Thoughts on Daniel and the Revelation. She noted, "The light was that thoughts on Daniel and the Revelation, the great controversy, and patriarchs and prophets would make their way. They, including her books and Uriah Smith's book, they contain the very message the people must have, the special light God has given his people. The angels of God would prepare the way for these books in the hearts of the people." Call Porter Ministry, pages 123 and 124. Ellen White wasn't done speaking of Elder Smith and his book. She says, "The interest in Daniel and the Revelation is to continue as long as probationary time shall last. God used the author of this book as a channel through which to communicate light to direct minds to the truth. Shall we not appreciate this light which points us to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, our King? Manuscript Release, Volume 1, page 63. Now I want to ask you a question. Do any of you, or do you know of anyone today, who believes that Ellen White believed every jot and tittle in Uriah Smith's book? I doubt it. And in fact, the leading proponent of the so-called 25-20 prophecy is very much against Smith's anti-Trinitarian teachings on the Son of God found in the original thoughts of Daniel and Revelation. Angels, friends, they guide, they help, they direct men today, but that of itself is not infallibility and does not give them a blank check theologically. And so now we're going to conclude. Larry Kirkpatrick has noted this, and I like the way he said it, and that's why I'm going to quote him. If truth matters to us as much as we often say it does, we should be willing to investigate carefully possible improvements to our understanding. To adhere stubbornly to an idea or a mistaken interpretation of a certain passage in the face of available clarifying information is no recommendation of our faith. Did you get what he said? If we really care about the truth, then adhering stubbornly to an idea is not right if it's mistaken. We should be looking for all the clarifying information we can on anything, beloved. It would be impossible within the scope of this study to go into the many teachings that are branching off of the 25-20. But friends, I hope that the truth matters to you. I hope it matters to you enough that you are willing to investigate each line and precept carefully, that you will look back through this presentation, or if you have the printed presentation, and look at every line and precept carefully and check every reference out. I invite you to check every reference out thoroughly in its context. Because as I did my research for this presentation, I was amazed at the mistakes I found in the research of others, both pro and con in this argument. But friends, we can all allow for honest errors. Honest errors happen. Typographical errors happen. Mistakes happen. We misquote a text. We give the wrong reference. But friends, we are told that God and heaven alone are infallible, so we can allow for honest mistakes. But however, when we are influencing the salvation of souls, beloved, continued errors, poor scholarship, and materials taken out of context, and even outright deception are not excusable. I would like to invite each one who hears this message to unite with me upon the platform of truth that James and Ellen White united, as well as Uriah Smith, Jan Andrews, Jan Loughborough, Stephen Haskell, and all those great reformers in our Advent movement, upon that platform and those great 25 fundamental principles, and let us move forward. Beloved, we do not have time to chase the devil's rabbits. To have taken the time to make this presentation, to do this study, has grieved me personally, because I think of other productive things I could have been doing instead of this. But beloved, as I mentioned to you earlier, I have brothers and sisters that I love more than my own soul. And they're involved in this, and they're making it a test of a fellowship now, and they're excluding people from their fellowship because of it. And we have to make this position clear that this is not a fundamental issue. It's not even a correct issue. And it's my prayer that truth and truth alone will prevail in these discussions. Several years ago, Robert Whelan and D.K. Short, Donald Short, wrote their manuscript, 1888 Reexamined. And if you don't know what that manuscript is, you need to find out and you need to read it. But in page 2 of that manuscript, they wrote this simple but profound statement. Absolutely nothing which does not bear the test of truth will be triumphant in the judgment. Did you get that? Let me finish with a statement from Elder Uriah Smith. Let it be settled, therefore, in every mind that there is no prophetic period of 7 times in the Bible, and every effort to apply such a supposed period is idle. Is idle. Now, as I mentioned, this presentation is going to be published in the June 2017 issue of Old Pass. We are scheduled to mail that issue Monday. Hopefully within a week. Most of you are hearing me right now. We'll have that available. Or if you're hearing this on the video later, that will be posted. It'll be available at our website, smyrna.org. It's a free download. and we'd like for you to study it and study it carefully. But I want to appeal to everyone who has become involved in this in a way that cannot be substantiated from the Bible. It cannot be substantiated from the writings of Ellen White. It cannot be substantiated from the writings of our pioneers. I want to appeal to not make this a test of fellowship. I want to appeal to those people to not make this the hobby horse that everything else rides upon. It is not whether we endorse Ellen White or not. It is not a test of Ellen White in any way. But friends, we need to come, as we read earlier, from Acts of the Apostles and unite together one another on truth. You know, someone has said, it takes a big man or woman to stand for the truth in hard times. But I want to tell you, sometimes it takes an even bigger person to admit that they were wrong and to come back. I think of Elder White. He wrote seemingly positive of the 2520, strongly positive of it in 1850. But later, he said, this idea is just, it's poor arithmetic, it's theological juggery. And he was willing to admit that he had been wrong. Friends, he was a great man. Uriah Smith was a great man, and he was wrong too, and he admitted he was wrong, and he made correction. Surely we can make correction too. And we have an obligation to make correction if we value the truth more than anything else. May God bless you lots and lots, and thank you for being with us.